Hi everybody and welcome to another video. This video shows new features, enhancements and improvements of the +1 guide release 12.0, like the guide user interface, media file support and updates on query component, debugger and vector-based screen editor. These different features will be shown in general and not too deep in detail. For the bigger topics like media file support of the DM10 and 1200 displays, we will provide separate videos. Please check out also the video of the new features of the +1 service tool version 12.0. So let's start with the 12.0 +1 guide and update center features. The release 12.0 does include a modified Danfoss license agreement. This new license agreement will be shown after first start of +1 tools guide, update center and service tool separately. This needs to be accepted and agreed for the end user license agreement first, and in addition, accept the way Danfoss may process your personal data according to the Danfoss data privacy policy. So as I said, this will be shown after the first start of guide, service tool and the update center. Before we move to the guide features, let's take a look to the update center where a few improvements has been added as well. Notifications will only shown if there are any changes since the last update interval. So the notification all items are up to date will only be shown once when the tool starts. When there are updates available for subscribed items, then the notification will be shown, of course. You can unsubscribe items directly from the download section and right click on the item and click unsubscribe. You could do this for a single item or for a whole group of items. Each item is shown with a description in front of the part number or product name within parentheses. The default download path has been changed since many IT departments have started to block running of executable files from the standard download folders. This default path will be used if no download path is or has been set before. Another improvement under options settings, where you can select automatically delete installed files to save disk space. When this option is checked, the download file is automatically deleted after it has been installed. This will not have effect on files like documents and or documentation and example applications. It only has effect on content and applications. So the +1 HWDs, libraries and the software development tools like guide and service tool. A new option, use custom My Documents folder, can be chosen to be set as well in the options settings. This setting does not affect Update Center, but Guide and Service Tool using the folder My Documents. When checked, the selected file path will be used by +1 Guide and Service Tool instead of the system default documents path after a restart of Guide and Service Tool took place. This setting is normally not needed but can be useful in case your IT department has configured your computer to not have access to the default documents folder when not connected to the office network. This path, for example, is used from my code folder link to manage blocks, C code compiles, code packages, modules, pages and the PLC units. The first perceptible enhancement in guide 12.0 is the modified startup time. The guide starts up faster by a multiple with older version because the key elements of libraries are now cached for quick subsequent loads. In addition to work faster with guide, the compilation speed has been improved, but keep in mind that there are still limitations which will reduce compile speed using classic screen or app lock component and projects using reference and object pages. The next noticeable change are some enhancements for the user interface. Since guide 11, where the first UI UX changes took place, additional changes in guide 12.0 has been implemented. First of all, guide user interface uses anti-aliasing and true type fonts, allowing for smooth lines and text. The icons and colors has been updated for a general contemporary look, and in guide version 12.0 the user has the possibility to select dark and light themes from the options menu. Especially in the dark when the monitor is the main source of light, it is rather uncomfortable and dazzling. So you switch from a white background to a black background with a contrasting color. This feature gives the user to select his own most pleasant background and light condition. The compile dialog for test, debugger and simulink has been modified with additional information. Below the progress bar, a new line has been added for each compile cycle. The name and order is filled in when the compiling process is started. When a cycle is completed, the time and result fields are filled in as well. As soon as cycle compilation is completed, you can click on result file, which will open the HTML file including the cycle compile results while the compilation sequence is running. This kind of separation of the compilation process gives a better overview about the compiling process at all, how many of the cycles has been finished and how many remained, with the order number for each compilation, and to see inside the result file what the problem was in this case. If there are 11 or more cycles in total, the compile dialog is sized for 10 cycles and a scroll bar is added. The compile dialog does include a break button, which will always be enabled until the compilation sequence is finished. If the break button is clicked, the compilation will be cancelled as soon as possible and shown with the text breaking, please wait. Another guide extension took place in the module viewer, which now supports print menu option and license manager to align with guide. Another enhancement in guide 12.0 when querying a time-based component. The value added field offers a drop-down list of all the supported timebases in the current sys file. In previous version, you had to type the value correct manually. Another query dialog improvement is the error indication when the user writes an invalid signal name or invalid combination of name, value and type in the query dialog. In previous versions, the OK button was disabled. Now there will also be an error text label that explains why the OK button is disabled. And in addition, the constant autotyped components for the 3- and 6-digit autotype will not show any type field in the query dialog. Also, the modifier list for the 3- and 6-digit autotype components will also include items to switch it into a typed constant. Let's switch to the debugger functionality inside guide. First enhancement, initial values. In debug mode, there is a new tab named Initial Values. This tab contains a grid with one line for every input. The grid of the Initial Values tab does include a signal name, signal type, and the initial value. For every available input signal, the name type and default initial value will be filled in this grid. The default values will be 0 for all integer types and empty string for string types. Note that the initial value tab will be synchronized with any input values that are specified on the first line of the loop inputs tab. So any change on the first line of the loop inputs tab will also be made to the initial values tab and vice versa. Next enhancement is run debugger. In both the loop inputs and the loop outputs tab, a new context menu item run to this line has been added. This context menu action will only be enabled for lines where the loop index is higher than the current loop index. When activated, the debugger will run until it reaches this line or it stops on a breakpoint, whichever happens first. The user interface will be updated continuously. For every loop index that is passed in this operation, it will still be possible to stop or pause debugging while this operation is running. If this operation is interrupted, either by a breakpoint or a user interaction, it will not resume automatically. Next enhancement, add watch. In guide 12.0, this added field has been changed into a drop-down list containing all input and output signals. Typing text into the field will filter the drop-down list. Signals that start by the type text will be listed first in the drop-down, other signals will be listed afterwards. Both parts of the list will be in alphabetical order internally. it will stay or it will still be possible to enter a text that is not present in the list of signals. And another enhancement is add CSV files. In guide 12.0 will be, or there are two new context menu items. The first one is the context menu item export to CSV, which is only enabled if there is any data available for exporting in the grid. This item exports all the data to a user selected CSV file. Second context menu item import from a CSV. This will work just like the use text or use test case as debug input and have the same sub items. This feature and the changes will be described in the following. So another debugger enhancement, use test case as debug input. This item was already implemented in previous guide version, but it has been expanded in a significant way. After selecting the item use test case as debug input, it shows the already known items at last, at first, replace existing debug input and merge with existing debug input. And a new menu action named custom has been added. If the user, the item custom is selected, then a dialog is shown where the user can select freely how to map from signals in the source data to signals in the loop inputs tab columns. The dialog will have one line for each available source data signal and a combo box with the name of the matching signal name in the loop inputs. If there is no matching signal, then the combo box has an empty value selected. The user can change the value of any combo box to any of the signal names available in the loop inputs. The OK button that if clicked imports the data and adds it last in the loop inputs grid. Via this additional item, the user is able to use different test cases in different projects and being flexible mapping the values to any needed or wished signal inside his application easily and fast. The last debugger enhancement I'm showing is related to the debugger input tab menu item. Some enhancements took place to delete, copy, and add lines in a more flexible and understandable way. Let's start with delete lines. In this feature, the text lines has been added to make the user interface clearer for the user. So the context menu and dialog title shows the same text, delete lines, and you are still able to delete a single or multiple selected lines. Next one is copy lines. Until guide 12.0, it has only been possible to copy a line from the previous or from the next line to the current line. In this feature, the copy from previous and copy from next menu item has been removed and replaced with the new menu item copy lines. This menu item copies all selected lines and pastes copied, copied lines. This menu item pastes from the previously copied lines to the currently selected lines. Then we have the add lines. Until guide 12.0, it was only possible to add one line at a time. In this feature, the context menu submenu named add line has been renamed to add lines. It has the same submenu items, but after selecting any of the submenu items, a dialog will show up to prompt the user about how many lines to add. After that, the corresponding number of new lines will be added in the position indicated by the user. And last but not least, a small simple toolbar is added to the loop inputs tab with the following buttons. Add line, when clicked, it inserts one line after the last selected line, or last if no line is selected. Delete lines, only enabled if at least one line is selected. After a confirmation dialog, all selected lines are deleted. And the last button is a select columns. It has the same action as the select columns context menu. From the debugger enhancements in guide 12.0, we move to the vector-based screen editor enhancements, which took place in guide 12.0 as well. In addition to the export screen definitions, the screens can be exported and import between the project and my code. So in guide 12.0, you are able to add single or multiple screens to my code, which can be imported or used for this or different projects afterwards. So let's take a look to the guide tool. In the project manager, there is still the screen definition folder, which does include all available screens. While right click on one or multiple selected screens, you can choose the option Add to my code to export and store that screen definitions under my code available for this and other projects. Under my code, a new folder screen has been added in which screen definition can be stored and used in different projects, like the screen definition I just added to my code. When the user right clicks on an ESD file under the screens node of the MyCode 3 and selects Add to Project, then the same action as the import screen definitions is performed, except the user will not be prompted to browse for an ESD file on the file system. Instead, the selected file is used directly. You can import the screen library contents to the root or separate tree, and you can directly import the code point set of the screen library as well. So an easy way to import export screen definition via the code guide interface, not using the screen editor separately, and to store and manage these screen definitions together with my code definitions in one place. Another enhancement in vector-based screen editor took place regarding stacking order. The problem in previous version was that it is difficult to handle the stacking order, and there were some defects as well, which has been modified in guide 12.0. The stacking order property has been located in the same place for each object, which makes it much more easier to find. Same for the menus, which you got from the screen objects, and from the tree objects do have similar structure. The last guide 12.0 enhancement I will mention in this video is related to hardware with media file support, like the new DM10 and 1200 displays. When using a DMHWD with media file support, a new media repository item will be displayed in the guide project manager. Via this repository, you are able to add folder and or media files to that project, like a PDF, MP3, MP4, text, JPEG, and so on. The media repository is stored in the project folder in the app media.dar, so it's zip file included as a guide project file if any media files or folders has been added to the project. You can copy this tar file and unpack the files, and you will see the same folder structure, including the files like it has been added to the media repository in guide. So these added media files and folders will be included in the LHX and downloaded with the application. To get the remote path of media file, use the copy full name when right-clicking a media file. The full name in the clipboard can then be pasted in PureU code or used in graphical code like widgets or generic viewport in the screen editor. Via service tool and the new implemented feature manage ECU media files, the user has got access to a directory or a folder to browse like an explorer or file manager, which gives the user the possibility to manage files on or to the DM10 and 1200 or USB and vice versa. This and other features will be shown in the What's New service tool video. We hope that you found this tutorial useful. Remember that PlusBon community help is available on the PlusBon user forum. Check out other videos on our YouTube channel or contact the PlusBon help desk. Thank you for your attention.